welcome to today's Keeping Current seminar. Enjoy the refreshments, courtesy of the Industrial Partners. And today we have one of our new faculty members, Greg Harrison, who will tell us all about whatever his life is, improving human AI interaction.
Yes. All right. So welcome, everyone. We're still 1 minute early, but might as well get started. It gives me one extra minute to talk about things. And now it's gone. As said, my name is Brent Harrison. I'm one of the new faculty members here. And I've had the just absolute great pleasure to meet a lot of you in the audience already. And I'm hoping that in the weeks to come, I'll have a chance to, for those I haven't met, to meet you, talk with you, because I love talking to people. And so I thought I'd take this opportunity to introduce you to some of the things that I think are really interesting. So this is a little bit of time for me to, for you guys to get to know me a little better. From the title slide, you can kind of figure out that my interests fall in this kind of AI space. I would say that I'm interested in both AI and machine learning in a broad sense. But to give a little more concrete idea of what I'm interested in, I want to talk to you a little bit about how I see the field of AI changing and evolving moving forward. So I think in the maybe not so distant future, AI is going to be about interaction. It's going to be about how do these systems play with humans? How do they get along? Currently, even a lot of the advances that we're seeing in both AI and machine learning are, whether or not the designers and developers and researchers know it, seem to be pushing us more and more in this direction. Some of this research is very, very obvious, how it's leading us towards this kind of human AI interaction. So for example, in robotics, there's this growing interest in creating systems that can directly cooperate with people to perform simple or complex mechanical tasks, such as like building a chair. There's research involving creating more and more sophisticated virtual training simulations to help train both military personnel, professional personnel, in order to navigate complex social situations. So this is another example where research is currently emphasizing interaction. And finally, the big one that I'm sure we're all super familiar with, self-driving cars, autonomous vehicles. While it may not be exactly clear how this is leading towards interaction, at some point in time, these are going to be on the road. There's going to be a person behind the wheel, even if they're not steering. And so the system is going to have to be able to account for that. However, even though this is kind of the state of the research, there are some issues. And it's mainly that these issues of interaction and how these systems can coexist with people aren't necessarily being thought about yet. And even if they might not be important right now, it's something that I see becoming important very, very soon. And to kind of give an example of this, I want to go back to this notion of self-driving cars. So right now, the research involving self-driving vehicles, a lot of it has to do with solving the core problem. How exactly do we get a vehicle to autonomously go from point A to point B safely? And that's fine. That is 100% a legitimate problem that has to be solved before these things can hit the road with people behind the wheel. However, we have to consider what effect people riding in these cars or what they're going to experience. So I have a friend who knows some people at Uber, and they are currently in, I think, Philadelphia, rolling out autonomous Uber vehicles for testing. So they'll pick up people in these autonomous vehicles and take them where they want to go. And people are absolutely terrified of these things. So much so that Uber has a human that sits in the passenger seat, and their only job is to calm people down. And they do this by saying, oh, yes, I know the system's it might be acting weird to you, but trust me, this is how it's supposed to be performing. Like these Uber cars, they brake super early because they're trying to be very, very safe. But it's something that feels weird to us as a passenger because it's not how we would drive.
So at what point the human no longer needs the explainer?
Generally, because it's a person, we actually put a lot of faith in them because we want to trust the, I know it's probably mostly a joke, but we want to trust the authority figure, and they're the authority figure. But at some point, we can't keep relying on this type of work. We can't keep relying on the human being there because that's very, very costly. It's not efficient. So at some point, I think the research has to shift, once the core problem is well enough solved, onto, well, how do these systems coexist with people? And that's the question that I'm interested in solving. That's what I find is incredibly fascinating. And so today, what I want to talk about, I want to talk about a lot of my interests today, and a lot of my projects, but I'm going to focus on these two. This is more recent work that I've done in the area of human-AI interaction. The first project is, and if you, I gave a talk here last year, and I'm sure several of you were at that talk, and so some of these things look very, very similar, but it's still, this is the work that was recently done. And so I apologize if you've seen this before, but it's still, I think, pretty interesting and pretty cool. So the first thing I want to talk about is creating AI systems that can rationalize. So you can think of this as the Uber problem. How do you make an AI system that can effectively communicate to a person what's going on and do that in a human understandable way? And the second project is, how can we create a system, or how can I create a system that understands, understands natural language? So how humans choose to interact with each other, how can we create a system that can support that kind of interaction? So we'll start with AI rationalization. I love my broken robot picture. So, AI systems are not perfect by any stretch of the imagination. They're prone to make mistakes, and they probably always will. But if you humor me for a second, let's assume that they were perfect, and they would find the optimal solution to any problem. It's entirely likely that people would still find fault with that, because now they're no longer solving the problem, or they might not be solving the problem the way that I would want it to be solved. Who's familiar with AlphaGo and AlphaGo's success against, playing? So AlphaGo was a system that played Go, and it, maybe a few years ago, beat a very, very high-ranking player in Go. And I thought this was just the coolest thing in the world, but not necessarily because the system was able to play Go at such a high level, but it's because of the commentators. See, there were these commentators that a lot of them were just baffled by the moves that the AlphaGo was making. And they would oftentimes question, oh, this is AlphaGo making a mistake. This has to be a mistake. It doesn't make sense. We've never seen any player play like this. And then maybe 30, 40 moves down the board, or down the road, suddenly everything makes sense. It's like, oh, no, I'm sorry, my bad. That was brilliant. That's just something that I wasn't expecting. And I think that these kinds of problems are going to crop up more and more as these systems become more and more integrated into society. I call this kind of either the AlphaGo problem or the Uber problem. And so because of this, there's been an increasing interest in creating explainable systems. So the notion that systems like AlphaGo, like Uber autonomous cars, navigation system or operating system, are black boxes to most people. And so we can't see the intelligence. We see the result of the intelligence, but we don't know how it's arriving from point A to point B. And so one strategy to cope with this is something called opening up the black box, clear boxing. So creating systems where these internal decision-making mechanisms are made public, with the idea being that I, the user, can now interpret for myself what's going on behind the scenes. And this is well and good if you have a lot of expertise in computer science and kind of interpret what these weights might be, or what these internal decision-making mechanisms might mean. But if you're not an expert, you're kind of left out in the cold. And I also posit that for sequential problems, clear boxing kind of, it doesn't help a whole lot. And that's because in these sequential problems, oftentimes behavior is governed by these abstract functions and trying to maximize these abstract utility or reward functions. So like in cue learning, in reinforcement learning, all agent behavior is about moving towards areas of the space with higher cue functions, and that's what it does. And so if we were to clear box that, I argue that this wouldn't be very helpful for someone who might not have a lot of computer science expertise. And I have another fun example. So I have a friend who helped design the game Fear, if this was maybe 5 or 10 years ago, this would be a super relevant example, but now it's a pretty dated at this point. But the game Fear is a first-person shooter, and it's squad-based. So you have your own squad of AI control teammates, and there are enemy squads that are coming out and trying to defeat you in combat. And so while this game had very sophisticated AI for enemies, it was really, really good. So good that testers insisted that the game was cheating. The reason that this is notable, the reason this is interesting, is so the opponent AI was something that the humans couldn't relate to. It was just too good. And so the only other option for them was that it had to be cheating. And so they reject this AI, even though I can assure you it was not cheating. And so in this case, one thing that you could do is you could again try to make, oh yes.
So I guess I don't understand the concept of cheating.
Oh.
Is it cheating if my opponent is smarter than me?
It's not. But if the player thinks that you are teleporting enemies behind them without them having to navigate the space, that is cheating. And that's what was happening. Well, they weren't actually teleporting, but that's what players thought was happening. Was that they were going along doing their thing, and then the game decides, oh, this is too boring. Bam, enemies behind you. Woo! And no one wants to admit that they got outflanked by an AI system. And so they had to be cheating. If we were to open up the black box, what we might see is that these systems, or this enemy AI, would simply say, oh, well, I was following the optimal path to get to you quickly, defined by like my nav measure, defined by some utility function to get closer to you very quickly without you noticing. But I have a feeling that would be very, that wouldn't go down right for a lot of players. And so what this company actually did was really, really interesting. They said, okay, we can solve this. What we're going to do is we're going to attach audio cues to our enemies, and we're going to have them say, oh, we're coming around this back hallway, be quiet, guys, to act as an audio cue to the players, to let them know that, hey, these guys exist and they're doing stuff in the world. So it made, and players accepted this, and this is currently, this is in the game. And so this is what I see as AI rationalization. Because this was a task where an explanation was provided that didn't necessarily state how the agent was getting to some, arriving to some decision, but it was something that humans understood, and it was something that existed within the context of the world that the humans found themselves in. And so this is kind of my, this is my formal definition, or formal-ish definition of AI rationalization. It's the process of creating explanations that are similar to what a human would make if he or she were controlling this robot or this agent in a similar situation. And this takes inspiration from something that humans do all the time. If I ask somebody why you chose to do something, anything really, you could probably come up with a reason. And chances are that reason would make sense, even if it's not the actual reason for you doing something. Humans are very, very good at filling in gaps, even if the things that we fill them in with aren't 100% accurate. Now I have a bunch of hypotheses about AI rationalizations. One thing that you'll notice is not listed there is troubleshooting decision making. Since AI rationalizations do not actually reflect how agents make decisions, don't use this to troubleshoot. What this can be used for is to help, at least I hypothesize, is to help build trust between humans and systems, or help, as in the case of fear, maintain immersion in virtual worlds and virtual training simulations, or even educational games. And these are concepts that are, can be vital to humans successfully interacting with these systems. So how do we do this? How do I do this? Well, my strategy here, there's a little joint diagram. My strategy here is to treat this as a machine translation problem. So instead of translating from one sentences in one language to sentences in a different language, I translate state information, so things that an agent might see in some environment, into natural language. So this might be the state of the world when the enemy is coming up behind the player in my fear example, and we translate that into this natural language. And how exactly we do that is we use this very, very nifty structure called an encoder-decoder network. And encoder-decoder network is comprised of two recurrent neural networks, an encoder, strangely enough, and a decoder. The encoder's job is to take in this state, a sequence of this state information, and first translate it into this intermediate representation, this dense feature vector, that's then passed into the decoder network along with the input in order to translate it into this natural language output. And so this is something that I've implemented in the game Frogger, and this is again a video that some of you might have seen, but it's also, I think, very, very fun. So every time this frog moves forward, it's rationalizing, so it's generating this text about what it's doing and why it's doing it. It's getting in state information, it's passing it through the encoder-decoder network, and it's able to generate pretty good sentences, or at least pretty descriptive sentences about what it's doing. So it can identify that it's currently in the area of the board where the cars are around it. It's able to identify that, oh, just then, it couldn't go forward because there's a car in the way, so I've got to go horizontally. I'm, in the interest of time, not going to go through all the ways that I've evaluated this, but what we find is that this system is able to very accurately identify or generate language that fits the context of what's going on. And so this is kind of strong support that this works for this type of problem. Boop. So now the question is, where do we go from here in terms of this rationalization? One of the biggest downsides, one of the biggest problems with this technique as it stands, is that it works mainly on single actions. So in the video there, it was rationalizing after every single action that it took, and it was rationalizing over only about that action. However, when we explain things, we don't typically explain about single actions. Or when we do provide explanations, it's in terms of this larger context. So if I were to ask you, why did you dodge this car by moving up instead of down? You wouldn't say, oh, I mean, there was a car next to me, because we kind of knew that. You would say, oh, I dodged up because that got me closer to my goal. And so one thing that this system needs to do is it needs to be able to reason about these longer-term goals and how these explanations fit into a larger plan in order to complete these goals. That's one of the things that I'm going to be working on in the near future. There's also a bunch of higher-level questions that we can ask about this, such as how does this affect the way we trust systems, how we trust systems, how intelligent they're perceived. And I'm also very interested to see if these systems can help maintain immersion in virtual environments. So if we create a world with a bunch of NPCs, will NPCs that are able to explain why they do the wacky, zany things they do, is a person going to be more likely to accept these explanations and those NPCs than if they didn't exist? So that's the first project. Now I want to go into, this is newer work, this is probably the newest thing that I've done. And it's using natural language to train virtual agents. Essentially, it's creating agents that can understand natural language. And I want to start with a little discussion on interactive machine learning, and then see a few people from my class here that I'm sure are sick of hearing me talk about interactive machine learning, but too bad. So interactive machine learning, the idea is that we want to have humans help train machine learning algorithms, with the idea that humans can often provide insight into problems that might be difficult for AI systems, such as sequential decision-making problems. And they can do this through a variety of different ways, including providing demonstrations of performing different actions to the agent, or critiquing the agent as it learns, so saying, yes, this action that you did was very good, no, this other one was not so good. The problem with this is that in each environment you want to have the agent act in, the human has to sit down and retrain all over again. Even if these, and this is a problem with reinforcement learning in general, but even environments that are related to each other, this human now has to sit down and watch the agent learn all over again. It doesn't maintain knowledge from situation to situation. Now humans, it turns out, we're really good at taking knowledge in one environment and applying it to completely different environments. And one of the ways that we do this is with language. So when I use the sentence, or when I tell you, I got into my car and drove to the store, this statement abstracts over many different conditions that the world could have possibly been in at the time. For example, I got into my car and went to the store applies equally to I got into my car and went to the store while it was raining, while it was sunny, while it was snowing, while my wife was out of town. All of these different things are all successfully encapsulated by this one sentence. And so the hypothesis here is that if we can get a system to understand these types of sentences, perhaps it can learn these kinds of abstract concepts and use them to transfer knowledge from one environment to another, with the ultimate goal of speeding up learning in semi-new environments. And I say semi-new for a very specific reason. So at a high level, what we want to do is we want to go from these sentences about performing actions in a world. This was also done in Frogger, so yay, Frogger actions. And we want to have the system able to go from natural language to state representation. So what does it mean to dodge a car? Oh, it means that I might find myself in a situation like this, and then I go up. And we're lucky in that we can also take advantage of these encoder-decoder networks. So this probably looks super familiar. I talked about it maybe 7 minutes ago. And turns out that if you switch the inputs and outputs, you end up doing just that, and you still end up performing very well at this task. So in this case, the encoder takes in natural language, creates its same thought vector, but now it's trying to generate what state should the world be in for this advice to apply. So what it's doing is it's learning, it's looking at this natural language and breaking it up and learning to associate certain bits of the natural language to certain parts of the state space. And what this enables us to do is it enables our little agent to query this model whenever it wants to get advice on what it should do in some state, even if it's not been seen before. And yeah, essentially what this is we created what I call a human advice oracle. So in practice, what this looks like is we have our little Frogger in this same state. And it asks the question, well, what exactly should I do here? This could be a state that it's never seen before. It could be a state that our human advice oracle has never seen before. But it can still ask the question. And what this oracle will do is it'll do its best to identify the most appropriate piece of advice, given what it's seen and given what it's learned about what it means to perform different actions in this world. So it might know that in this situation, I see, like, this most matches a state where a lot of people talk about dodging cars. And whenever people talk about dodging cars, they typically go up. So that's what I'm going to suggest you do in this state. So a little underneath the hood, what this means is that we use the model to calculate the probability that a certain state matches some advice, best be associated with some advice that we've seen, and use that to determine the best action to take. And then what we can do is we can actually bias the reinforcement learning exploration phase to prefer these. And then as it learns, we can lessen the bias more towards its own experience. I do want to briefly talk about the way we've evaluated this. So again, this was in Frogger. What I did is I trained this model using a grammar that generated some natural language and would associate it with various states in a map that was not one of these. So these are my test maps. The agent never saw these. The neural model never saw these. The Oracle model never saw these. But what we find is that across all of them, you get ridiculous speed. Well, maybe not ridiculous, but you get significant speed ups. So in this case, I apologize to the colorblind. I'm colorblind. For using red and green, but the red is our language-based learner. And what we find is that, yeah, it converges to maybe not an optimal policy, but it learns very, very quickly a policy that is pretty good. And it learns much faster than a base Q learning system across all maps. And remember, these are maps that the agent has not seen before. And it also outperforms a kind of custom Q learning agent that has only access to the observations that we fed in to the neural net, so not the language. And so what this tells me is that the inclusion of natural language plays a big part in improving learning in these unseen environments. And so moving forward, we have kind of the same problem that I did with rationalization, in that oftentimes when people give advice, it's more in a larger, it's with respect to a larger goal trajectory rather than single actions. And so learning from those is a top priority moving forward. And also, I currently have only used this on permutations of a world. For true transfer, you have to be able to perform different tasks but are still related. Perhaps there are different state representations. And so the question of how exactly to generalize to those unseen environments is currently on my mind. So yeah, that's where I'm going with that. And so those are the two projects I wanted to talk about. Now I just kind of want to shotgun a bunch of things that I've done in the past that I'm still interested in. But these are kind of the big things on my plate at the moment. So other Brent mentioned last week that I'm interested in games. A lot of my previous work has been in games. And so some early work that I did was on reducing churn in games by creating these adaptive environments. And so churn is this notion of a player quitting, a player stopping playing a game and never coming back. So in the industry, this is something that's very important to people. And so what I did was created a model that could identify when a player is going to churn, but it would also alter the environment to try to keep them playing longer. And it did so not by like cutting off opportunities for the player, but it did it by improving the experience. So this player model was able to tell it that, oh, this player prefers these types of activities. So let's try to guide the player towards these things. And I was able to show significantly reduced churn in two game environments that I created, as well as improved experience, but I didn't put that on there, by various qualitative measures. This was a cool one. So when you're creating a game, playtesting is super important. That's how you typically find bugs in your game. However, it's not perfect, because we as humans aren't perfect. So one, it's very time consuming, and two, players don't often, they're not able to explore the full possibility of possible actions you can do in a game. And so this was a work with a collaborator, Alex Zook, who I think is at Riot Games now. He was at Blizzard at the time. Using Monte Carlo tree search to simulate humans for playtesting. So we were able to do automatic playtesting on Scrabble and a game that looked a lot like Hearthstone, but was not Hearthstone. Key subtle difference. And how we simulated these people is we used look ahead, which is a parameter in Monte Carlo tree search, to control for skill. And what we found is that Scrabble was kind of boring, because it turns out Scrabble is a well-balanced game. So we found that, you know, things kind of made sense. In the card game, that's where things got really, really interesting. What we showed is that in this simple version of Hearthstone that we had implemented, we could identify that the player going second just had a horrible disadvantage, no matter what. And the reason, if you play Hearthstone, is because you know that the person going second has an option to, for one turn, speed up their own growth. They're going to get like one more mana. We didn't have that card. And so what that said was that, or what that did was it made it so the person going first had a huge advantage, because they'd always be one step ahead of the other player until you got to the very end of the game. And so that's something that we didn't even think about when making this game, but we were able to figure out using this automatic playtesting, and I thought that was super cool. So this is something that is also an ongoing project, but it's not as new or as, I won't say pressing, but I just kind of put it on the in reserve for now. But it's using narratives to train virtual agents. So stories are nifty. Stories contain a large amount of procedural knowledge about the world. You could look at children's stories. Children's stories are founded on describing to children how the world works. And it's also one of the primary ways that humans talk to each other. And so the thought here was, why can't we use these stories to train virtual agents? If humans want to convey information using this task, this should make it an easier task for people to do, if only agents could understand the stories. And so this system, which I call Quixote, does just that. It takes very simple stories in a very, very specific representation and engineers reward functions for reinforcement learning. I don't have results on here. Using these stories. And this has also been evaluated all the hell. And if you want to hear more about it, I can surely tell you more about it. But we showed that this approach was able to successfully generate or get agents to learn behavior that kind of mimicked what it saw in the stories that it was told, which is really, really cool. So I have 1 minute. No, Okay, so this is my conclusion. I really want to get to questions. And so, yeah, that's my talk. Ask me questions. Go! Okay, we got one.
In the Frogger bot, what yes. was the like measure of goodness of robot?
In the rationalization? Or, so which Frogger bot?
The one where you had three charts.
Yes. So cumulative reward. So what it would do is it would look at, if I train for this amount of time, my optimal policy currently, how much reward does that actually get me? So the longer it trains for, the better the policy, the more reward it would get you.
Reward is like staying alive or getting far?
Yeah. So every step, when it got to the end of the game, it got a large reward. And so by making it to the end more consistently, you increase your cumulative reward. Yep, yeah, no problem.
You'll notice that early on it did very poorly.
Yes, always does poorly early on.
I'm afraid we'd have to hold off more questions until later so that Hank has a chance to get his talk. I'm sure we'll have more questions for you, and it's good you're in this building.
Yes.
Welcome to the department.
Oh, thank you.